Well, hey there, Chase Oaks. My name's Greg. I'm one of the pastors here on staff. And just as Jeff shared in that video, as important as it is for him to be with his family right now, he hates not being here with us this weekend because this is an important weekend in the life of our church. Because this weekend, we are launching a brand new word that is going to become a common, everyday word in the Chase Oaks lexicon from this day forth. And you guys know what that word is? Established. That's right. And I'm going to talk a whole lot more about why this is such a big deal for our church. But before I do, I want to ask if you can think of, in your mind, any other words or phrases that are now common in our culture that maybe 10 years ago we wouldn't ever have thought of. Can you think of any? Yeah, I hear a couple that I made a short list here, pretty quick. We got bromance, which I think is a pretty cool word. Unfriend, which we never would have used before Facebook. Brexit, hater, emoji, huge. Hashtag tweet and twerk. You know, on that last one, I'm a little fuzzy. Could someone demonstrate? Would someone be willing to? Any takers? Any? No? Okay. You know, there's another phrase that has just become really popular that we didn't hear much of before just recently, and that is fake news. You know, last year, a year ago, no one was talking about fake news. You know, and then that phrase initiated or started as a way to describe, you know, Facebook posts that were completely, you know, ridiculous, that people were sharing like they were real. But then that phrase has grown, the definition has grown to describe, you know, our distrust for media outlets that might be, you know, slanted or biased or something like that, which has caused a lot of people then to ask the question, okay, which news sources are trustworthy and not, and all of that. But then in such a polarized society that we live in, fake news has gone on then to define or to mean pretty much anything that disagrees with my point of view, right? And that whole topic of fake news is kind of low-hanging fruit for someone like me to make fun of and to tell some funny stories with, and I was tempted to do that because it would be fun. But I'm actually more inclined to agree with Tim Cook, the CEO of Apple, who says, fake news is not funny because people actually believe it. And beliefs matter. Our brains long to make sense of the world, and so we kind of create sort of grids and systems by which we interpret our experiences and the news that comes in. And we all do this. We all sort of have our lenses. And we are all prone to believing things that aren't true if they happen to agree with our system, right? If they happen to fit in there. And it's scary how easy it is that can happen because we're all prone to it. We're all prone to it because none of us are unbiased. None of us are. And it's scary because when we do that, when we believe something that's not true because it happens to fit within our system or in our grid, it just reinforces wrong thinking, which makes it harder to realize the truth next time. And when we believe things that aren't true, it takes us further and further away from the truth, and that is scary because beliefs matter. What we believe to be true shapes our worldview. And it shapes our understanding, and it shapes our perceptions, and it shapes the decisions that we make. Our whole, you know, direction of our lives is shaped by what we believe to be true. And so if my beliefs are skewed, then my understanding of reality will be skewed, and my whole life will be skewed. And as dangerous as that might be, as we're talking about news and, you know, world events, it is catastrophic when we're talking about our perceptions of God and spiritual things. When I was in seminary, which is just graduate school for pastors, I had a professor who would often begin his classes with the same simple but profound statement that I have been wrestling with now for 20 years. And the statement is this. He would say over and over, the most important thing you will ever think is what you think when you think about God. The most important thing you will ever think is what you think when you think about God. And his point is that when I think about God, if I perceive him as a permissive God, or alternatively, if I think of him as a harsh, judgmental God, or if I think of him as aloof and distant, or maybe inept and weak, or maybe kindly, you know, forgetful, grandfatherly, man upstairs type, or whatever. However I perceive God, that is going to affect how I perceive myself, how I'm going to perceive the world and things like natural disasters and sickness and the presence of evil in the world and my future and like so many things. You know, it's such a huge, important topic that if I'm off, if my lenses are wrong, if my understanding of the world in that particular area, it's going to affect so many things. And likewise, other topics that the Bible talks about, you know, the big areas of life, like relationships and money and work and values and those types of things, if we're off on those, if we're not rooted in biblical reality, then we will never fully flourish and live the better way of Jesus and the abundant life that he came to bring. And this is a really important topic for us to consider, because there are a whole lot of ideas that float around that just sound true, that just feel true, because they fit in my grid, you know, in my system. They just feel right. It just makes sense to me. But they have no relationship to reality. And when we believe those things, it takes us down a weird path, and it affects us negatively in multiple areas of our lives, and oftentimes in ways that we don't even recognize. So here's a kind of a scary question. What if much of what we believe to be true about God and about ourselves isn't true at all? How would we even know? You see, we have to have something that is outside of us, something that is sure and trusted and true that we can base our lives on. This topic was weighed heavy on the Apostle Paul. And Paul, you know, was a leader in the early church, and he was kind of the one appointed by God to launch the church, at least among the Gentiles, like us, the non-Jews. And as you might imagine, it was very important to Paul. He was passionate about introducing people to this way in which they can be in right relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ. He was passionate about sharing the good news of Jesus. He was passionate about seeing people convert to Christianity through faith. But he was also equally passionate about seeing those people rooted and established in biblical reality, because he knew that if they didn't have good roots, if they weren't well established, then they would be vulnerable to any type of good-sounding teaching that came after him. And they would be vulnerable when adversity came, that they might just blow over, that they wouldn't be strong enough. Last spring, when all the storms, you know, those multiple storms came through North Dallas, at our house in my backyard, we had a tree get knocked over. And it was really strange because it didn't break like at the trunk, you know, and it didn't break up like in the branches where I would assume that it would break, because all those leaves, it's catching the wind and all of that kind of stuff. It broke below ground. And so we had this whole tree lying on its side right next to a hole where the trunk used to be. And I could look down in the hole in just a couple of inches, you know, I could see where the roots had sort of broken off. It broke at the roots. It wasn't well rooted. And I think that is the thing that Paul, as we're going to see in just a minute, just labored and worked to try and prevent in the people that he was introducing to faith in Christ, because if they weren't well rooted and well established, they would be vulnerable to all kinds of weird thinking and going down strange paths. And that's what the whole concept of, that's where established comes from. Is that as important as it is for us to be in relationship with God through faith in Christ, it is also extremely important that we be rooted and established in biblical reality. I want you to listen. We're not going to be able to really dissect and pull this passage apart and look at it, but I just want you to listen to Paul's heart. This is in a letter that he wrote to the Colossians. It's towards the end of chapter 1, starting in verse 28, and it's through the first seven verses of chapter 2. But just listen to Paul's heart. Jesus is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. To this end, I strenuously contend with all the energy Christ so powerfully works in me. I want you to know how hard I'm contending for you and for all those at Laodicea and for all who have not met me personally. My goal is that they may be encouraged in heart and united in love so that they may have the full riches of complete understanding in order that they may know the mystery of God, namely Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I tell you this so that no one may deceive you by fine-sounding arguments. For though I am absent from you in body, I am present with you in spirit and delight to see how disciplined you are and how firm your faith in Christ is. So then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Now, did you catch there in those last couple of verses? I want to highlight this again. Just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught. This is presented to us as a command. He is telling them to be strengthened, which is kind of an interesting way to think about that. You know, when I go to the gym and work out, and I engage in the weight machines or in the free weights, I can rightly say that I am getting stronger. But I can also equally say that through engaging in these machines and engaging in these weights, I am being strengthened. It's sort of like something that is happening to me. The weights are strengthening me. But even though I can sort of present it in this almost kind of passive way, that doesn't mean I can be passive, right? I can't go into the gym and lay my hands on the weights and say, strengthen me. As awesome as that would be. It is up to me to engage in that process and to do the work. Likewise, God roots us. God's word and the teaching of the apostles establish and strengthen us, but it is absolutely up to us as to whether or not that's going to happen. So we are commanded to engage in the process so that we might be strengthened, so that we could dig our roots deeply into something that is sure and solid and trustworthy. You know, we see the importance of this played out in how the early church was formed. You know, I mentioned just a minute ago that Paul and his companions would go kind of from city to city and establish these churches. But the way that they did it and their strategy was the same no matter where they went. And so they would come into a new town and they would go into a public place, maybe the synagogue or an open marketplace or something like that, and they would preach the good news of Jesus Christ. And there would be detractors, and they would, you know, a crowd would come, and there'd be people that were against them, but there were also people that were curious, and usually there would be some people who would believe their message and place their faith in Jesus Christ and become Christians. And they would continue that maybe on the weekends, on Sabbath, you know, do the open air things, but during the week and in the evenings, they would stay in that town for a considerable amount of time, teaching those new believers and strengthening them and establishing them. And then the ones that really kind of got it and learned and showed promise to be able to teach others and to give oversight over others, they were appointed as leaders And when they did that, when Paul and his companions could appoint leaders over that little community, then they knew they could go to the next town. They could move on to somewhere else. But so often what happened at least in the first missionary journey, is that they would experience persecution and be run out of town before they could finish their process. They'd have to leave early. And this really came to a head in Laodicea. In Laodicea, the Jews who were against them whipped up a whole sort of mob of people that ran Paul and Barnabas out of town and then stoned Paul and left him for dead. I want you to picture that. I mean, Paul laying in the dirt, I mean, he would have been pelted so many times in order for the mob to say, okay, that's enough, he's dead, or he's as good as dead. And Paul is laying there, and he's bloodied, and he's bruised, and his companions are around him mourning. And then, you know, Paul eventually stirs and moves and then maybe sits up, and we don't know what he said first. It was probably something like, man, my head really hurts or something. But we do know that he, in that setting, he said these words, "Let us go now to the next town so that we may preach the gospel there also." Like, man, what a stud. And the next day, they're in Derby, and they're starting the process all over again. But in Derby, they're able to finish the process and kind of bring it to completion. But then at that point, instead of going on then to the next town, Paul says something that I think is even more amazing than what he said before. And he says to Barnabas, "Let's go to the towns where we've already visited so that we can strengthen or establish the believers there." Now think about that for a minute. I mean, there are places on the planet that I don't want to go because I feel like they'd be too dangerous. These are towns where there's people that have already tried to kill them. They are putting their lives on the line so that they can re-engage with those believers and make sure they are rooted and established so that they could have lives they could have fruitful lives of impact and be able to live the abundant life that Christ had for them. And they are risking everything for that. Why such a risk? Because for Paul, it wasn't just about converting to Christianity. It was also about rooting those believers into biblical reality so that they could experience the type of life that Christ wanted them to experience. Because they knew that if they didn't, I mean, and you can sort of remember that those believers in those towns, they didn't have Bibles, right? I mean, the New Testament was just being written at that time. It hadn't been compiled yet. And these would have been Gentile believers who didn't grow up in the synagogue and weren't well accustomed to the teachings of the Hebrew Bible, which is our Old Testament. So their understanding would have been really spotty. And so they knew enough to believe, but then Paul was, you know, forced out of town. And so Paul knew that if they left them that way, unestablished, with shallow roots, that they were vulnerable. They were vulnerable to all kinds of different teachings. They were vulnerable to being blown over, you know, when adversity came. They were vulnerable to be led astray. You know, I think just about all of us could look back at times in our lives when, in one degree or another, we were led astray. You know, it could be that, you know, circumstances we just interpreted wrongly and it took us down a weird path and, you know, and we were just sort of led astray by our own misunderstanding, or maybe there were all the voices around us were saying the same thing and we just sort of believed it and, you know, it just sort of led us astray. In fact, I want to ask a question for all of the males of the species here at Legacy, at Sloan Creek, at 544, I want you to answer this question. For all the men, I want you to raise your hand if you are in your 40s. All right, 40s, come on. You can be bold. This is my tribe here. 40-year-old men in your 40s. Okay, those guys, and I want you to be honest, you're among friends. You can be honest. For those guys that just raised your hand, how many of you in the 80s had a mullet? Come on. You can be honest. I did. I got my hand up. Sophomore year, I'm telling you. You know, I asked my mom if she had any pictures that I could share and embarrass myself with of that time in my life, and she looked through several boxes of pictures and stuff, and oddly enough, there seems to be no record that I was ever that age. You know, there's no, but not to deprive you, I thought I'd give you a little peek into Greg as a sophomore. Now this is, there you go. This is a little more extreme than I had, but I definitely had the, you know, business in the front, party in the back thing going on. You know, and for me, it seemed like, you know, 86, 87, it seemed like everybody had a mullet. At least my friends did. It felt so right, you know? I had been led astray. You know, even more to me, even a little more embarrassing than this, as embarrassing as that is when I got married and Kelly and I began to have daughters. You know, I grew up with all brothers. I was surrounded by guys my whole life, and so I kind of had my grid, my understanding of the world made sense to me growing up in a household full of guys, and I had no idea how inadequate my understanding of reality really was, because, you know, living in a household full of women, it's a different set of rules. You know, there are rules to things. There's rules for what you know you're supposed to do with the toilet seat, and there are rules for, you know, which bodily noises are okay, and which ones aren't. There's rules about when, if ever, it's okay to laugh at someone else's appearance. You know, growing up with all brothers, that was like a daily occurrence in our household, you know, but it's like, that's not the truth, evidently, you know, because now I can hear just a really innocent question, like, how do I look? And in my mind, it's like, warning, 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 you know, that just because I had sort of everything figured out and the world made sense and I had my grid doesn't mean I was living in the truth. And when we're kind of askew, and when we're off, and when we don't know the rules, and we don't know the truth, we can get ourselves into trouble, and we're prone, and we're vulnerable to all kinds of strange thinking. And I think that's what Paul is saying, that in a spiritual sense, that when we are, that when we're off, when we're not well grounded, We are susceptible to any voices that might sound great, that might lead us down a terrible path. So we have to have something that is strong and secure and sure for us to dig our roots into, something that is outside of ourselves. And that's why I just want to point to this verse again, because I think it is so good. Paul says, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught. Several years ago, I had a good friend of mine who was a horticulturalist at an arboretum, and he was my go-to guy for questions about plants and trees and all of that. And I remember one time we were in a car together and we were driving and we went by a house and some people that had trees, and they had just recently mulched their trees, put mulch around their trees. And these are decent sized trees, and they put mulch almost like a little donut around the trunk. And he kind of rolled his eyes and chuckled a little bit. And I said, hey, what's that all about? And he said, if you want to mulch a tree in a way that would actually be beneficial to the tree, or the roots of the tree, or if you would ever want to, fertilize the roots of a tree, you have to go all the way out to the drip line. And the drip line, if you can picture a tree, the branches and the limbs that come all the way out to the outside, if you were to drop a string at the outside reach, that circle that comes all the way around, that is the size of the root system underneath. And in fact, you know, if you were to, in terms of size, what you see above ground is mirrored below ground. And in fact, any type of growth that you see above ground has most likely already occurred below ground. And so that is what established is all about, this new tool that we're launching. It is about developing our roots and digging them deeper. It's the below ground work. And so we are launching this thing that we are inviting every Chase Oaker to jump into, regardless of where we are in our journey. All the, you know, from one side of people that are not trusting in Christ yet and are just investing in Christianity, investigating Christianity, all the way to those who have been following Christ for years or decades. Regardless, the challenge is to see this weekend as the baseline, not the finish line, and then invest a decent amount of time and effort to dig our roots deeper. Established began with a fairly simple but profound question, and that is, what is it that people would need to experientially know for Paul to consider them established enough that he could leave and go to another town? So Eric Torrance and our whole adult ministries team sort of grappled with that question, and they worked on this for a year and pulled together a tool that really is pretty incredible. In just a moment, I'm gonna have Eric come out and talk to us about this and how we can use it and jump into it. And when Eric comes, I'm gonna ask that you not only welcome him to the stage, but also thank him and his team for just the incredible amount of work that it took to pull this together. So Eric, would you come out?
Thanks, Greg. We are excited this weekend to be releasing this workbook at all of our campuses. It's been a long time coming, and it is a substantial book, and what I mean by substantial is it's big. And there's some benefits to having a big book. One is you've got an automatic, you know, pump and iron kind of thing going on, which this is a good workout for someone like me. And the other thing is you automatically look smart. I mean, there's great ways for us to look smart. Greg does it by putting on glasses. You look about 10 times smarter than I last saw you, so that's great on that. But this can help you out with that too. But for some of us, you're looking at the size of this substantial book, and maybe you're stressing out a little bit because you're like, Eric, I am not a reader. And so I don't want you to stress out. In fact, we don't think this is a stressful tool. We put this together in hopes that it'd be a helpful tool to you. Wherever you're at in your faith journey, whether you've been following Jesus for a long time or aren't a Christ follower at all, that this would be a help to you. So let me explain to you kind of how the workbook works so that it's not stressful and see how it connects with you. As Greg mentioned, about a year ago, a team of us sat down to really think through transformation at our church, transformation in our own lives, and what it would look like to help all of us take steps this season and even ongoing as a church. And so we sat around as a team and listed out all sorts of different issues and questions and topics and ideas and really thought through and prayed together of what it would look like to kind of intentionally map that journey into something that we think could be helpful and give all of us a pathway. And that's where Estabslished was produced and started that journey for us. And so when you get it, if you already have it, and if not, when you get it after the service, you'll notice on the cover there is an image that we've been using quite a bit, and it's the image of a tree ring, or really a tree. And that image is cool because it's a biblical one. You know, as Greg was talking about, the image of a tree is one that God used repeatedly throughout the Bible to illustrate growth to you and I. And why it connects so much is that when you think of a tree, growth is both organic and intentional. Let me explain that. It's organic in the sense where God uses lots of different things to grow us, sometimes unexpected things. I mean, as you think through your own story and those moments where you felt like, okay, I'm taking big steps with my faith in this season or in this moment, that sometimes that's unexpected. Whether it's some kind of event or some kind of person or some kind of message or just something that kind of popped out of nowhere and it's like, oh man, God's just speaking to me. And those are cool, and he definitely does that. But growth is also intentional. And like a tree kind of puts its roots down into the ground intentionally each season, or even as this tree ring shows where it's like each season kind of layer by layer builds on itself, that's how our faith should work too. That as we approach God and as he starts working in our lives, that we make effort to build on our faith layer by layer. And so this workbook is meant to help us kind of have some intentionality to the organic side of growth. And so the way that it works is it's a 10-week journey, which is a substantial journey, but it's a 10-week journey that really starts at this core where we're all at, where we look at our world and kind of ask, you know, questions about what we see and what we experience and what would cause us to know God exists and who he is. And then from that beginning journey, we start to build on it layer by layer of, okay, well, how do I come to that with Jesus? Who is Jesus? How can I trust that he actually existed? How do I understand the New Testament, the Old Testament, my identity? And so each of these different weeks build on itself and kind of layer by layer so that by the end of it, our prayer would be that you would feel very intentionally established where you feel like, okay, I know kind of from start to finish how I could start to layer out my faith a little bit more. And so each week, you'll come with a particular theme, and inside the workbook, there are 5 days a week of different kind of, not meant to be overwhelming, but substantial, like 15-minute kind of reflection, reading, activities, things that'll get you into God's Word. Some of that is very reading-oriented. Others of it, like Greg did an adult coloring book page, where there's a verse that you can kind of meditate on and color in an image. And some of you are like, that's awesome. And others of you are like, I'm not coloring that in. And I get it. I get it. I totally get it. You should try it, though. I think it'll be kind of cool and soothing. But either way, there's some surprises in this that we've put in there just to make it so that we're hopefully engaging lots of different senses and lots of different things to build on it. So each week, there's an individual component. And then we also then get together with groups of people. So there's a group time that is written into this book as well, where you can get with other people and talk about it, because we need each other to balance out different ideas, ask our questions, really challenge it, and that's where growth tends to happen. And so when you look at this, this isn't just one straight thing that you have to read all the way through. In fact, there's substantial space in here to read and reflect, and then also the group times are explained in there too, and so it's all kind of wrapped up into one big package so that hopefully it'll be a tool that you can use to go forward with. And so this weekend at our campuses, we're releasing it. It's in our lobby space, and so a lot of you have already pre-ordered it, so it's available for pickup out in the lobbies. If you haven't, it's available for purchase for $20, though we don't want costs to stop anybody from doing it. And so if that's a factor at all, just go out there and talk to someone. We will work it out and make sure you get a copy, because it's that important to us to make sure that this is a season of growth for you. But we also wanted to make sure this was something that felt substantial to you, maybe something that you'll keep around for seasons going forward as you need reminders of your notes and your journals that you could come back to it. And that's why we designed it the way that we did. And so our hope and our feeling is that this is a really cool plan. It's not a perfect plan. There's no magic in this book. There are lots of different tools of how to grow in faith, and this is one of many that are out there. But we do think it can be helpful, but it won't guarantee growth in your life. Because even though we can have a great plan, that doesn't mean that we'll actually take steps in our life. For example, each year I have a desire to go to the gym and get healthier, you know, work on weights and all that sort of thing. I think a lot of us have that. And so around January 2nd, January 3rd, I get onto my smartphone. Maybe you can identify with this. And I download like 3 or 4 different fitness apps. Have you ever done this before? All right. And for me, like, my insecurity is I always worry when I go to a weight room that I'm not doing the weights right, you know? Like, no one wants to be that guy in a YouTube video where they're like, oh, that I can't believe this sucker and how he's doing that. No one wants to be that guy. And so I download the one where, you know, they show you like a guy doing the video of all the weights and he's like really ripped and everything, and I'm getting inspired. And so I download it, you know, and look at it, and then I don't go to the gym. Can you identify with that? Some of you are like, Eric, we know you don't go to the gym. We can see that. It's cool to have a great plan, a great app or a great thing, but the growth happens when we make a commitment to reach out of our comfort zones, to do something stretching together. And we believe there's power in doing that together, that oftentimes when we get with a group of other people that are helping us in an activity, whether it's our health, our finances, and specifically and especially with our spiritual growth, that when we get together, we can help each other take big steps, and that's our goal. So we want to make it as easy as possible for you to get with other people to go through it. So it's not just simply selling books or even buying books. It's hopefully getting the resource and then getting into a group. And so if you're in a life group, your group should already be doing that. So just get the book and go to group. You should be good to go. But if you're not in life group, we have a special website that you can go to actually right now. So if you want to humor me, you won't offend me at all if you actually pull out your smartphone right now. So go ahead and do that. And go to estabslished.chaseoaks.org. Estabslished.chaseoaks.org. And when you pull it up, it'll look something like this. I mean, on your phone, it'll probably shrink it down a little bit. And so scroll down, and there's a button that says find a group. So if you want to find a group, pick that button. You know, that's the one to do. And so if you pick on that button, it'll take you to a page that looks like this, where you can put your information in. And then what's really cool is you can select what campus you're at. So whether you're at Legacy or Sloan Creek, 544, each campus has some easy options for you to be able to engage with a group. At Sloan Creek and Legacy, we are starting new groups that will meet on-site, which will be really easy for you to jump into. And so it gives you that information there. At 544, there are lots of life groups that are mentioned there that want to roll out the red carpet to you and say, hey, come join us for this 10 weeks. So when you click on that, the form will actually expand out, and you can select whatever options we're offering at that campus. Fill out your information. You can even sign up for childcare if the campus is offering that. So that's a great thing. And then you can hit submit, and you'll be good to go. You'll have the information of what you need. We'll send you an email, but you can also just show up to the group that you sign up for with that. And so let's make a commitment together to, it's not just buying a book, let's make a commitment to actually stretch out of our comfort zones together and make this a big season of growth. And we can't wait to hear the stories that'll come. So yeah. Thanks, Greg.
Thank you, Greg. Now this is a trajectory changing weekend for a whole lot of people that jump into this. You know, as we've already been talking about, when we are not well grounded and well established, we are vulnerable in ways that we may not even realize. And some of us actually can sense that something's not quite right within us. You know, like, it's just, I should be stronger than this. I should know my Bible better than this. Or I shouldn't be so fragile, you know, when life circumstances change or whatever. And I just want to be more solid. And that's what Estabslished is all about. And, you know, as Eric said, this is 10 weeks, you know, it's 5 days a week, me and God, you know, and my Bible studying, but then also every week getting together with a group. And that is, in a culture like ours, in a busy culture like ours, that is a lot. And I'm not going to lie and say this is going to be easy, because it probably won't be. And not only are our lives overly full, we also have an enemy named Satan who does not want you to be established and well-grounded. Because when we are not well-grounded and established, it is much easier for him to pull us off track and away from the abundant life and impactful life that Jesus wants us to live. And so Satan will do what he can to discourage us, to discourage you. And so you just need to know that going into it. But also, the busyness, which makes it intimidating to sign up for something for 10 weeks, that busyness is not going away. And so we just need to know that going into it too. We're going to have to muscle through. We're going to have to make it a priority and pray that God will keep us focused and help us finish what we start. Because I cannot imagine anything that would be more life-shaping and impacting than a season where we really dive deep into God's Word. You know, in 10 weeks, this will be the last thing. In 10 weeks, you're going to be 10 weeks older whether you commit to this or not. And so the question isn't so much, can I afford to invest 10 weeks in something like this? The question is, in 10 weeks, where do you want to be? Where do you want to be in your relationship with God? Where do you want to be in your understanding of theology and how this all works and your understanding of the Bible? And if the answer to that is you want to be somewhere different than you are today, then just make it a priority. Make it a priority and stick to it, and I think you'll be glad you did. So let me pray, and then we'll let the journey begin. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much that you have not just left us on our own regarding the big issues of life and regarding our understanding of you and ourselves and how the world works. Father, you have given us your word, and I thank you also now that we have a tool through we can kind of systematize things and we can learn some of these really important truths. And I pray that you will use this in our lives and that you will dig our roots deep and that you will make us strong. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.